This session on sets and relations, part one, will be introduced to sets today. We need to know something about a collection. Basically, when we are kids, we collect toys, and nowadays we all collect a lot of video games. So all these collections, which are a group of similar objects together, we can call them as a set. So why do we need to know about sets? Let's say we have a whole bunch of toys all spread out in a room, and we want to divide them into different groups. So we probably want to put the soft toys together, we want to put the outdoor games together, the video games together, and so on. Now all these, when we are grouping them together based on similarity, we are actually forming sets. Now suppose you want to combine these different types of toys together and work with them, then mostly we'll be using sets and their operations. It just makes things easier for us to view things and perform operations when we are dealing with certain objects. So it's just to make life easy for us. That's why we use sets. Now let's look at the background of sets a little bit. Set theory was actually started by the German mathematician George Cantor in the 1870s. It's actually defined as a collection of well-defined distinct objects. Now, what do we mean by well-defined? We actually mean we have to give a clear picture of what goes into a set and what doesn't belong to the set. In that way, it has to be very clear. And we also want distinct objects that such that we don't have repetition of things. So these well-defined distinct objects are actually called the elements or the members of the set. So these elements can be numbers, alphabets, animals, people, whatever you want to put into the set, you can put them by similarity. Now, how do we write sets? There are a couple of ways. First one is where we list the elements. We write the set name in capital letter usually, and then in curly brackets, we put the elements separated by commas. Now, let's say we want to look at a set of toys. So, we write the set name as A, and in curly brackets, we put the different items. Okay, so we have four to five different items. And as we said before, each of these is actually the element of the set. Now, when we look at each item or element, we can look at the teddy bear and we say it belongs to the set A. And the symbol for that is the epsilon or the E-like symbol. And we say that belongs to A. Similarly, for the red toy car, it also belongs to the set A. So we use the symbol epsilon and then we say it belongs to A. Now, let's say we want to look at an element that doesn't belong to this set A. How do we write that? For example, we are looking at letter D. It's not part of this set. So, we say it does not belong to the set A. Now, for that, we use the symbol epsilon or E, but we put a slash across it and then we say it does not belong to the set. Let's say we talked about distinct elements of the set. But here we are saying set is B is of big and small English alphabets. So when we write the set, we have small a and big A, small b, big B, and so on. Now we may say, okay, A and A, they are not distinct or there is a repetition here. But based on the set definition, we said we can have big or small English letters. So that means it is allowing, the set is allowing duplicates in this case. So it is still valid. But if the set doesn't specify such things, then we need distinct objects. Now the second way to write it by specifying a property. This property has to apply to all elements of the set. Let's look at set N, which is a set of natural numbers. This is the general convention that we use. N is set of natural numbers. 1, 2, 3, 4, so on. Now for that property, what we are going to say is we're going to define a variable called x and say x is a counting number starting from 1. Now this colon here is actually called such that. So X is such that X is a counting number. Some people, instead of colon, they also use a vertical line. Okay. So you can do either one. Now, if you want to write a set of natural numbers less than 10, how do we do that using properties? We get started with set name, and in parentheses, we are going to have a variable X such that X is part of N, and this means it belongs to, so X belongs to N, and then we have written X is less than 10. So how do we read this whole property? We say X is such that X belongs to N, X belongs to set of natural numbers, and X is less than 10. So this is how you would read a specific property of the set. Now, is every collection a set? We said collection means it's a set, similar items. But look at this example, a batch of intelligent students, or let's say a group of interesting items, or a collection of postal stamps. Now, when we look at some keywords like intelligent and interesting, those are not very well defined, in the sense intelligent does not have a clear definition, and neither does interesting. What is interesting to one person may not be interesting to someone else. So when we say group of interesting items, it is not well defined. Similarly, intelligent. So these two, because they are not well defined, they cannot be called as sets. But a collection of postal stamps, it's a postal stamps everywhere, so it is a set. Let's look at the cardinality of a set. Cardinality is the number of elements that we have in a set. Now here we have A equal to books, pens, pencils, so on. And so the number of elements here is 5. How do we write the cardinality? We put the set name in parallel lines and we put it equal to the number of items. So set A here has 5 items, so that's the cardinality. One thing to note is cardinality of a set is always greater than or equal to 0. You may wonder, how can the cardinality be 0? Can there be a set which doesn't have any elements? We'll look at it in the next few slides. Let's look at the type of set. The first one is the empty or null set. Obviously, that means it does not have any elements in it, right? Now, for that, we use 2 curly brackets next to each other and we don't put any elements in it. Or we use the symbol phi, or actually the 0 with a slash in it. That means it's a null or empty set. Now, how can we define a null or empty set? Let's look at a set of cars with 25 doors. Okay, when we look at a car, we have 1, 2, 3, 4 doors max, maybe 5, 6, 10, whatever it is. But 25 doors, that means this set is not going to return any elements. So that means it has no elements, and that's why it's called as an empty set. Now, the cardinality of the empty set is 0. This is exactly why we said previously, cardinality of any set can be greater than or equal to 0. Let's look at a singleton set. Singleton, obviously, single means just one element. So, the cardinality is 1 for this set. Here's an example, D equal to 5. Now, we can also say A equal to this empty set. Now this actually means an empty set, but A is a set of an empty set. Because the empty set is in brackets, we say it is a set of an empty set. What is a finite set? Obviously, if a set has countable number of elements, no matter how big it is, if you can count them, that means you can finish counting at some point of time, then it is a finite set. If we look at the number of people on earth, it starts from 1, 2, 3, so on. Let's say approximately 7.6 billion, which is a huge number, but still it is countable. So this is defining a finite set. In finite set, obviously the set extends to infinity. We cannot finish counting, so it's headed towards infinity. Now let's look at the set of integers. on either side, we have dot, dot, dot. That means actually these two mean the set is continuing in each direction, left and right directions. And so we call it an infinite set. So there is no limit to it. Equal sets. Sets obviously have the same elements. Okay. Here we have A equal to 2, 3, 5 and 7. B is 3, 7, 5 and 2. Okay. Do they have the same elements? Yes, they have 2, 3, 5 and 7. That means they have the same elements. Order of the elements is not important. Remember, when we are dealing with these kinds of sets, we are not talking about the order. We didn't specify anywhere that we need them to be in a specific order. So order doesn't matter. But when we look at the elements, they are the same. Cardinality is the same. So cardinality in each case is 4. A and B have a cardinality of 4. So the equal sets have same cardinality. So we say A is equal to B. Equivalent sets, that means they have the same number of elements. Okay. If A includes these three backpacks, the cardinality here is 3. B includes X, Y, and Z or Z. Here the cardinality is also 3. But are the elements the same? No. These are different elements from each other. So they are just equivalent sets. So we see elements are not the same, but cardinality is the same for equivalent sets. Can a set be an element of another set? Let's see. Now we have a set B which includes certain bags. And we have A equal to sunglasses, B and shoes. This B and this B, I want to tie them together. Okay, if we want to tie them together, then what should we do? Because sunglasses is an element, it's not a set, but B is a set. So what should we do? We should put the brackets around B so that we know this B and this B are actually connected. This means it's a set B. Then we have the element shoes. So set B is an element of set A. Now let's look at some standard sets. We saw this standard set for natural numbers, which is called as N, and we declared a property for that. Now we have the set of whole numbers where we are saying X is such that X is 0 or X belongs to N. N is the set of natural numbers. Okay. Now we have Z or I as the set of integers. So the integers keep going infinitely in either direction. So here we are saying the property is X contains negative of natural numbers, which means all the negative numbers or X equal to X belongs to W. W means it starts with all the 0 plus the natural numbers. Now Q is a set of rational numbers where we have P by Q, numerator by denominator, and both of them are integers. Now R is just a naming convention for set of real numbers. Now let's go over the symbols and notations that we used in this presentation. We said epsilon or the E-like symbol means it belongs, that means element belongs to the set. If we put a slash across it, then we are saying it does not belong. Colon or a single line, vertical line means such that. That means the variable is such that it follows some rules. Two parallel lines and in between gives us the cardinality of a set, which is the number of elements. And the circle with a slash in it is the null or empty set, set with no elements. When we have three dots, it means the set is continuing. So, for a quick review of what we saw in the session today, we said set is a collection of well-defined distinct objects where each object is called as an element or a member. So, two ways to write the set. One is a list where we have elements separated by commas. Here is an example. And we say one belongs to A. Or every element belongs to the set. Another way is set name, where we define a property that applies to all elements. Here is an example where we say 2 is less than x less than 10 and x belongs to the set of natural numbers. The cardinality of a set is the number of elements. So here the cardinality of M is 5. Now, what are the different types of sets we looked at? Empty or null set, which has no elements. So we put two brackets next to each other, or 0 with a slash. Singleton set has one element. Okay. Finite set means it has countable number of elements. Even though the number could be very large, as long as it's countable, it's a finite set. Infinite means it's not finite. That means it keeps on going. Here is a set of natural numbers. Actually, this should be N, which is set of natural numbers. Or we have equal sets, sets that have same elements, exactly same elements. Equivalent sets that have the same number of elements. That means their cardinality is the same, but the elements are not the same. So thank you for watching this session. We'll catch up with you in part 2, where we'll be discussing about subsets. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.